Welcome everyone to the fifth episode of TGY again. It's been a while since we last talked, and one of the obvious reasons was the pandemic. In a non-obvious way for me though, because it mostly meant that I have a office mates who, you know, doesn't always appreciate having someone mumbling at the background in an actual important class. The second one though also being that apparently servers can catch COVID as well. So the server hardware that I've been originally running the project that we were doing here went down. It seems like the network card died and the access was limited. So I actually spent a non-trivial amount of time rescuing data, figuring out how to move it around, and launch it temporarily on Amazon. So actually, when you go and see the project, this is now running on EC2 in a very minimal configuration. This probably is something that I'm going to discuss in the future as well. One thing I did there was to properly describe it using Terraform. That was actually harder than I'm used to, because I've been using Terraform at work on non-trivial projects, which is, you know, there you kind of expect the complexity. But for a simple project like this was, it was kind of unexpected for me. But it went well, so that one is running. But as a side effect, you know, where we have been deploying before, that doesn't work. And in a true cult fashion, I don't really feel like we should be deploying in the same way and to the same instance. As a side effect of migrating, I have also actually tried to clean things up and, you know, killed some of the more hacky things that were happening there. Just open a window. So we are going to figure out in this episode how to deploy to Heroku. So it's probably going to be a bit shorter and less exciting episode, because this is something that you can do pretty easily for new projects. But I still wanted to show it. Like, we have something that is being made from scratch, but in collaboration with the older project. The largest disadvantage of what I'm going to do is that there is... Like, the shared database is running on RDS, the Relational Database Service, as Amazon calls it, which is a managed database. So, you know, we don't take too care of processes and, like, you know, proper MySQL configuration and whatnot. But it requires RDS to be open to the world, which I wouldn't recommend to normal projects. But there is no way to do that more securely. You know, as of 2020. Let's figure out how to move our Django application to Heroku. So what I did as a preparation was that I set up the secrets, you know, like the credit card and domain verification and CNAME and whatnot. So soon our previous domain should be redirected towards the new location. We have to start by setting up the proper Heroku deployment procedure. Now there are three options. One is the one that Git was famous for, which is, you know, Git push Heroku, which is basically set up a remote Git, deploy on push to it, where it's going to comply its own container and deploy it. Container being basically let's call it their own version of Heroku, Docker. We can do similar, but connected to GitHub, so take use of some of the integration, or use container registry, which allows us to build Docker containers, which is something we are doing for CI anyway, remember, and just deploy it using Heroku CLI. Now, the advantage of last option is that if we would figure out how to make production Docker containers and, you know, maybe build them on Circle CI. It would also allow us in the future to migrate away from Heroku if we would choose to, and for example use ECR, the Amazon's Elastic Container Service, to run it. You know, if we would decide that the production deserves, I wouldn't say more robust environment, but a way to have more control and at the same time have a bit of cheaper scalability, because Heroku can get expensive pretty quickly as you scale up. But that's probably not what we will encounter on this project. And my beef with connecting stuff to Heroku directly is that while I do think that master should be deployable at any time, I don't necessarily feel that it's a good idea to do so in a normal project environment. Now, this is not exactly the case. This is more of a personal project, so I'm leaning that we go and try to do that. But it is my, I mean, source of disagreement between me and my team, like multiple teams that I've had in the past quite often. I really don't like Git push master to automatically deploy. And the reason for that is that as the project grows in complexity, the pipeline inevitably grows. It is rare for me to see sufficient test coverage and have a time between Git push to deploy under 5 minutes, or, you know, under 3, which I think is roughly the maximum time period at which people are willing to sit at computer and pay attention. And I think that goes beyond, people switch. And when they switch, they often forgot about what they have been doing. And when they switch and it's, you know, afternoon, later afternoon in the day, they tend to also move home. And this brings a risk of deployment being done when someone is on their way in the traffic, going home, disconnected. And sure, you know, things going through the deployment pipeline means that everything should be covered and everything should be fine. But I mean, every deployment is a risk. So I'm still in the camp that everything should be built. There should be a container ready. But there should be someone like manually saying, now deploy. And from that time on, the deployment should be initiated within a minute. You can emulate it on Heroku, actually. There is an API for you to do that. But this is an overhead for what you're going to do. So let's connect to GitHub. So OAuth login. I do have quite a bit of organizations. Now it would be nicer for me to use the key, but magic of 1Password. Let's hope nobody's sniffing. So let's connect to our graveyard repository. Also, in this sense, the review evacuation milestone no longer makes sense in its original purpose because we were off the server. But it still means we are not switched to default as an application because we're just not ready for that. But I should rename it. So let's connect to the repo. And enable master deploy after CI passes. Now, let's. I actually don't think that we need much of a configuration to deploy in this sense, because we do have a pretty standard project. managed by run server should deploy, and Heroku should be able to discover that. So let's see whether the Django and Heroku, whether it makes sense to put in some configuration. But otherwise, I would deploy an OOP. Commit should be done. So we do have requirements. Requirements, I think that we have in a subdirectory. So let's take a look. I would hope that they would also detect manage.py for Django. But it seems not to be the case. We do have requirements. Okay, cool. So collect static would be run automatically. We can run with the latest, I think. So 3.7.2, what we are on. So let me source into the environment that we had. Ah, I always forget that Python 3v stands for verbose, not version. Okay, so let's declare that as of time of this writing. 3.7.3 is what we want. I would prefer the minor versions to be updated automatically. But let's see. Right, we have been doing the new creation pages last time, so let me just put this into master. So one thing that also one Git trick that you could do, so this is the head of the branch, so we can go to master and cherry pick that one hash and push it. Now I need to remember. Right, I'm on a different computer, so different password. And now if we go to GitHub, I'm actually now not sure how to see the status of the commit if I haven't been doing a pull request. But we can definitely look it up directly in the Circle CI. Let's see what went wrong since the last time. There is always something. One fun side effect of only developing time from time is that everything expires. Uh, everybody optimizes on you using their tools every day. That's where the money is from. Alright. Now, while we were not paying attention, Circle CI even released a new UI, and I mean, since you're waiting for the result, let's see how it looks like. Alright, new pipelines, which I'm not sure we are using actually. So Circle CI, I think we do. Circle CI originally was kind of built on the previous idea of what Circle CI is as a series of steps. They add a bit more flexibility towards that. So we now do have a success. So everything seems to be working well, including the tests. 2 minutes. So let's see what Heroku thinks of that. Build failed. Of course, view locks. Okay, so we have to have static root configured properly. This goes to the fact that if you look at our settings, kind of the poor boys version of Django settings, we have divided it in between. Let me show. Here. So settings.py, we say that we have, you know, the base that's shared between all environments, Circle specific to CI, our local settings, and then a production example that sets all the important bits. Now, this, at least some of it, is overridden on production by having this, you know, production.example.py renamed to production.py, which is not what we are doing here. So what you need to do is to load all of those from environment variables and set those environment variables to production. And let the application figure out that it's running on Heroku, and that it should use those environment variables. This is a bit more secure than what we've been doing. Also, a bit more annoying to set up, require some work. What's running in my mind is some of those. There are two different types of variables here that are mixed in that may be worth for you to think separately of. One is production settings that are not secret. So like the fact that we are, you know, have all those SSL redirects and secure settings and whatnot. There is no problem with everyone knowing that we have those on. There is a second class of them, though, which are secrets. So, for example, the DSN on Sentry, that's sniffable. There is an API key that can be used to control the account. they definitely should be publicly available. Obviously, username and password, our secret key that we've been using. One thing that made me lazy about this is that I actually need to figure out where this file is in my backups. I mean, we can also regenerate all those keys, but it's annoyance. So part of me says that having a file like this as a file that's enabled by a certain environment variable and the rest of the secrets only reading from environments is what I want to do now for time being. Of course, if you're going for more secure application than is a hobby site, then you want to have a proper solution for retrieving secrets. That can be either cloud specific, like our major cloud providers have a secret management solution, or you can use something that's cloud independent. Probably the best one currently is Vault by HashiCorp that I'm aware of. But it is something that also requires like maintenance running, is a single point of failure, is not trivial to set up, and is a bit of an overhead for this one. Let's take a look. So in the init.py, this is where we are deciding how to import the files. So we're importing the production file purely based on the idea of whether it exists. So what I'm saying is let's introduce an environment variable that will say whether we are whether we should import the local or the production. I think that there is a one on Heroku that I actually recommend, but I don't remember it. My guess would be env, but let's take a look. Well, actually, we should be able to see. So no configuration variables for our apps. Okay, so let's say that there's going to be environment production. So if, let me go back, so this can be replaced with os.environment.get, I think. Let me double check. So which is a dictionary. As long as we import it. And also potentially having secrets, as you can see, none shown, but still. So if that's set, if it's not set, it will give us this. So, or it can be boolean. Yep. So I would argue that it's more readable. So we can do git environment get. And skip the double check. And in a similar fashion, let's call it actually runtime more than environment, at least. The environment, although, I mean, like, the environment is a habit. That's what people use for configuration. But I really think that runtime says more about what it is. So if it is production, then let's import everything from dot production. And are we going to require local for local development, or are we going to pass silently? I would say that for time being, let's pass silently and assume that production is not local. That said, this is something that we should document later, that we definitely should document once we pass it, because this is exactly the magic that confuses people when deploying. So local is default, I would actually say let's rely on the detection, and if you're overriding it, you should know what we are doing. Otherwise, let's use value error. So let's also just check that we are still able to run this. Am I already running this? Let me check. Right. I'm playing with another setup. Cool. Different port means that I need to configure, and that's a URL nerf. I have migrated from static host names to actually having a domain. And this works. Okay. So, we need to have the production committed. So I am actually saying, let's just copy the example. Just rename the example, I mean. Graveyard settings production will be graveyard settings production without example. And we will just require those keys to be present. I hope we're only catching the import error here. No, we are not catching anything, so we can actually erase keys as key errors and not be caught. This is important to check. Sometimes people are doing like top level try catch, and then some of the obvious programming mistakes get catched in a way you don't want to. So secret key. I'm going to say at the top of the file, let's document what is assumed. So following is assumed to be configured in an environment variables. So secret key. Database is seed is assumed. I am going forward and say that let's make this configurable as well. So there's going to be database name. Well, we do have one. So let's shorten it. So yeah. Let me copy paste this around. So DB name. Password, obviously. Username is it, I hope. Let's double check with the docs, because people are always mistaking those. And it's not user authentication. In settings, database, caches. We will assume the engine name is the database name. Cool. Password. Right. Port we need to set for RDS, and time zone you're leaving. Right, see, so this is exactly why we are looking it up. It's user, not username. Although I really argue that I'm unifying on username. It is more verbose, but as like whenever I'm deciding on verbose versus less verbose, is whether there can be a easily imagined confusion. And since this is environment variables for the whole file, I mean user and username, it can be, you know, the DB name, DB user, DB user could kind of work, but no negotiation. It is a matter of opinion, but I think this rule is way more explicit. Cache. We're going to hardware for time being. Domain as well. For people who are going to deploy this, they can alter it. Now this is actually a problem. So what we've been doing before was collecting a static to a different subdirectory that was then served from a different domain. I don't think we can easily do that on Heroku. Of course, the correct way to do this is for this to get deployed to CDN. The alternative way is to designate a static list subserved subdirectory, which is not recommended, but workable. Let's see whether there is an easy way to have Django collect static for S3 or something similar. Unsuitable for production. So what do they offer in terms of deployment? Okay, so this is not included with Django, it seems. I do wonder whether we can't do temporarily, since this is not a production yet, whether we can't do a grossly inefficient version unsuitable for production. But I think that it's actually needs to debug through. So this is the downside of a server forcing you to do the correct thing. You actually have to work on it. Let's just see whether Heroku doesn't have a way to do this easily. Apparently it knows what we can do. Okay, white noise. I have a feeling that that's going to be a partnership and it will need money. Let's see. Okay. So, including confirmed witness check. Also, of course, of note, you know, as with any third party dependency. Think about who's writing. You're essentially entering a contract, so be aware of who's writing this. What is the chance for them to go rogue? Obviously, this depends on, you know, how much how much paranoid do you want to get about how much paranoid do you want to get about the security of your project? Because for example, it's just I still consider this mostly a hobby project, with data partial leaked actually. So I'm willing to have a third party manage my settings, but it may not be the case for you. So I'm going to say let's risk going with those. So the only problem is it using this? Yes, it is using the static. It is using the static framework correctly, so we shouldn't need to do the annoying alter templates part. But we will need to alter middlewares. It's still okay. So let's take this for a separate commit though. So fix me, because I think that getting a proof of concept, seeing that the app is up on Heroku, is going to be more important for time being. So let's move this. Also, I accidentally saved to the old production.example, so let's move this up. So static is for migration, that will need DNS fixes anyway. This is a nice example of a secret, so let's call this center DSN. Again, let's not forget to mark it in the doc string that got lost in translation. Okay, so let's not forget about it and do this all over. So this assumes the following environment variables to be configured. So Sentry DSN is one, and then there was the database, so let's go again. And also let me actually make a note about this one before we accidentally kill it. So this is going to be our template. And we have agreed that database name is configurable. Then there was the user. Prefixed passwords. And port is the one we need for RDS. Hey, Steven. Max H, I'm willing to hard code, and charset is actually not configurable because if you remember, we do have this non-trivial recoding layer that just assumes that the original database is in the condition it is, and it's not easy to move it. So let's not forget to document those, because this is a common source of surprise. And actually, right, it's DB port. Let's not forget to namespace, otherwise things will get ugly. So name port, right, the secret key is something that we also forgot. So and actually let's call it jungle secret key, just to make it also obvious. There will be more secret keys on the road. Code center DSN and the rest of it. Is fixed and can be public. Okay, and so just to go past the compilation phase, let's put the static route in TMP. I mean, that should be able to send it to dev null. This will rely on our RDS configuration. And we should be good. Just one thing that I don't see here, that is actually super important, is setting debug to false. I think that this may be the default if you're not running through run server, but I'm always making sure to have it because that is something that if you have it set to true, that's a major security risk. That's something you should always be paying attention to definitely not happen anywhere. I would actually set up monitoring on that. Like that's one thing that, you know, you should have security monitoring for that there is no traceback on production at any time, because this is super easy to accidentally overwrite, and it's a very easy to have a very funny production incident, well, security production incident. I mean, I can promise you'll get experiences during such incidents, but it's not fun. Migrate production configuration to be Heroku friendly. And let's see what happens. Now, meanwhile and off screen, I should actually look those up and configure them. So let me temporarily shut down the screen. I mean, yeah, I can be hiding as well, but it's the screen that I'm trying to get rid of. And let me look it up, because this requires me going through potentially secret files. So fortunately, in the anticipation of the server going down at one point, I actually do have the previous file stored. So let me use the Heroku set config. Now, this is one of the problems with environment variables, to be honest. It's also super easy to accidentally display it somewhere, which, especially if you're doing recording, you know, can also lead to some fun. But for the purpose of this, this is doable. So So I'm setting the secret key. I am setting the database name. Database passwords. Right, and we will also need to do the same for database host, because we have been running on localhost, but that's not going to be the case. And one thing that I can't find in my notes is the proper centrid SN. But we can for time live without that. Yeah, I will need to look it up. So yeah, I'm always uncomfortable saying usernames and passwords unobfuscated on the screen. So on the background, I'll show you afterwards, but let me add the the DB host to the configuration. And speaking of, let me connect to my AWS account where all of this is running. That's also new since last time. And I've been actually going back and forth on whether it's best to use Amazon for this. In terms of, I'm running this for almost 20 years. Next year is going to be 20th year of running this site. So while now I would, I could definitely afford paying more, I've kind of optimized for it for to scale down and for it to be able to run low profile, let's call it, so I can sustain it even if my money situation would get worse significantly. And surprisingly, Amazon is still the best for this kind of work, at least based on what came out of my calculations. Which is surprising, because I thought that Google and Google Cloud Compute and Azure are competing on price. But it seems actually not to be the case for basic resources. It may be the case for services on top of that, those are actually not option much for this project, mainly for those legacy reasons. So let me just wait for my RDS to go up. So I still have my database instance. Also, a very interesting side effect of this was to look up on all the ways you can downscale, because cloud definitely lets you to scale up properly, but scaling down, not as easy as I thought it would be. Unless you're going for lambdas and whatnot, but then you also need to. That requires the whole application to be written that way, which is something I would definitely do now. but you know, not 20 years ago. So db host, and now I have password in my bash history. So let me actually terminate this and alter my bash RC. Bash history, because as I've been saying, this always bothers me. Okay. So I think that we can go back to have a screen. Let's see what happens. So let me resize so you can see. We should have everything that's set. I think I haven't committed, right, I haven't committed the database host option, so let me do that. Let's push this and see what Circle thinks of it, but we haven't kill this one. Also, I keep entering the wrong password, sorry for it. Let me hide this, and so let's see whether our fiddling with the environment variables haven't broke tests. It seems not to be the case, so let's see what the Heroku thinks of our new configuration. Build failed, for what reason? Because I have pushed this before setting DB name, right? Of course. So now everything should be in sync, so let's wait for this to run, and then this should get ready. Also, for the purpose of not screwing up the production, the fact that it fails during build time, I consider good actually. So let's see. Also, until we upgrade to production, this is unfortunately going to be running without HTTPS, because I think that HTTPS is only available for paid dynos. So once we'll be closer to production, I'll happily pay, but for now, I think it will not be working. But first thing first, I have the build run. Oh, 2 minutes, okay, let's wait. I've been thinking that maybe meanwhile we should document those configurations in the actual documentation. But let's first see whether it actually works. This should be only a moment. And yeah, when looking up the alternatives, like when migrating the app, I've been looking at various alternatives to Heroku, and like the higher level services that the providers do, like AWS have actually a pretty interesting concept called CodeStar, which would be nice if it would work. But the problem is that it really is in a stage where it's a scaffold of services, and it is not working well if you want to make any changes. It's like it falls apart. So let me quickly go off screen with this one and set also the DB username, which I apparently forgot about. Which restarted the app, but I don't think that it rebuilds the app. Like it doesn't rebuild the Slack. So in that case, let's do what I've been talking about and move this to docs. So I think that there was a infrastructure, okay, testing, configuration, right, production. So this is deprecated, I think. But let's first migrate and then say that it really is. So assumes following environment variables to be set in production. See settings directory for more info. By more info, I mean like more mapping. And yeah, star is used. So gosh, I always forget how the shortcut is on different platforms. Alt Command F, okay. Alt Command F. Yep. So let's commit that. Try again. Let's just take a look. Yeah, setting configuration environment doesn't rebuild the image, which makes sense because the image should actually be agnostic to the environment variables in ideal case. It is mostly that this is a bit of a hack, like having a built environment variables versus production runtime variables. Like in the correct environment, you have those in different build files, and the production environment is in the secret storage. But Heroku, to a degree, guides you towards this abuse, actually, as you know, the default to everything is to do the environment variables mumbo jumbo. Also, why I don't mind the new Circle CI view, it is optimized for larger screens. I don't blame them, but for the purpose of webcasting, it is a bit suboptimal. Or it's mobile first, I don't know. Skills for that. Let's see what would happen if we would go to mobile screen. Yeah, definitely responsive. as a user, I'm always torn on whether you should assume mobile based on the window size, because still mobile for means for me mostly means you're using thumbs instead of cursor, so less precision, and that's what you should adapt to. Okay, so Heroku, what are you building? We are. So let's see our image V8. The famous highly emotional three dots, regardless of whether it's computer or human typing. Okay, we failed again. What have we forgotten this time? Right, that's entry DSN. Oh well. So not so optional. So let me pull it out. In here, I mean, I think that the last time I've been doing this, I had to rotate the keys afterwards. So let me please let me put it aside and make sure I'm not screwing this. As well as last time, I'm not entirely sure. Oh, here it is. SDK setup client keys. Am I really off screen? Definitely hope so. I do have multiple keys here and I'm not sure why. So that's maybe something for me to set up. Just let me make sure and turn the screen off for the time being. Set sentry DNS. DSN, I think. And let's do a dummy commit. So installing in Docker. Let's make a dummy commit, in effect dummy commit. hopefully not. Hopefully not completely dummy. In effect. But yeah, I think that you can see from the podcast like how much time is application versus infrastructure, unless you're willing to pay for it. And even if... I think for the last 30 days when your reporting is broken. One way to achieve zero bugs. A lot of people working in a corporation would be familiar. So So how's our pipeline? There we go. So let's clean up this project. So maybe let's align the names and call it, how do you call it? Let's call it production ready, I think. And here is critical path to be able to beta tests moving. I'll shutting original server down. I ran a reserved instance there, which says something about my ambitions for this, I guess. But I hope to beat it. And just to make sure, let's say graveyards production ready, this new app. So linking is what you wanted to do next. Linking and proper creative pages section. So that's cool. Just document what you're doing. Migrate to Heroku. And that's yes, convert to issue. Because we want to have checklist for this. So I'm saying what we are doing now is run skeleton on Heroku that connects to RDS. Fix static files. Well, let's call it fix static files is the goal, but I think that in its current stage, let's serve them from CDN. Figure out SSL is the next. That's all I can think of right now. Oh, mailing. Figure out sending emails. That was also done locally, and I think it won't work in on Heroku. And we'll need to have a third-party service. So of course I hit the wrong link, but we can still update command. Cool. Do we have a label for infrastructure? We do, it's just off screen, since labels don't work well with small screens. That's also interesting to know. This is a common UI gotcha, that like you overflow screen and you can't really scroll down if you overflow in a lot of cases. It's not Revy the server anymore, but it is Revy the EC2 instance, fine by me. So 63 is going to be our top priority. And seems like we have deployed. Cool. do have Heroku Postgres installed, which actually we don't want to, but whatever. Let's add a dyno. And we need prots files. Okay, so let's commit a prots file. I forgot that that is mandatory. Okay. So let's set a prots file. It's going to be web and it's going to be Python 3 managed by bind tool interfaces on the port provided by Heroku. And it is on graveyard and save as prots file. And let's see whether it will work in Heroku's environment. I somehow always thought that the default is, you know, to figure it out, but yeah, let's see. And I need a break, so let's commit and wait for it to come back. So see you in 5-10 minutes. Bye. Welcome back. So let's take a look what happened. So we do have a success on pipelines. Would be weird if you wouldn't. And if you reload our dynos, we do have 3 dynos. How many of them? One that is on. Cool. So let's also see whether the CNAME work correctly. Not HTTPS, I'm afraid, in this case. This looks suspicious. Why we are behind the hashtag? So let's take a look in console. I mean, nothing beats looking at the raw code. So $200, okay. This is a very weird code. So we do have a packaged JavaScript. This is weird. And this actually looks what is this? So once upon a time I've been building a Vue.js version of this application And this looks like it, except I have no idea how it happened to be connected to this. So I have questions. Yeah, this is the view. What? So I mean, whoa. So the view version was this one, I think. Yeah, this was the Vue.js project. It is a completely different repository that we haven't even touched. And I would be really interested in how the fuck did it, if it's the one that's there, how the fuck it compiled into this project. I mean, we can also take a look at the Heroku logs, but I doubt there's going to be something important, actually. Like, we'll see. But something weird is happening. We are also attaching to that test to that example Heroku free database, which we should be free to delete. I'm also not sure what we are serving, since based on the logs, this is crashing because the way we have entered it, it can't pass this parse the syntax. Although, you know, because we forgot about run server. But why? I mean, it can be my browser cache. So let's just make sure. And I'll try it in a different browser. Let's take my Brave. Wait, it can't be a browser if this is what showed up in Corel. But wow, this is weird. And I don't remember serving it from Heroku, but I may be wrong. Let's just see. Okay, so I know where we're going. So this is an old old IP. So this is pointing to the original to our new EC instance that's containing the original product. That still have the remnants of that view compiled there. I have updated it since, but it seems not to be reflected. So right. So this is 208. What was it before? Huh. Now I'm very confused. Because there is a CNAME that is resolving to the same as the upstream. No, that's weird. What is this? Or is it that the CNAME is there accidentally twice so unrecognized? No, this is the bad format, because the CNAME is actually ending in .dart.cz, so this is wrong. So let me go off screen for a bit again. This is though actually common. You may encounter that as well. The trick is like when Heroku asks you, for example, in this case, to copy paste that CNAME. Like various registers with various, let's say, interfaces. They have a different approach to how they interpret what you put in, because sometimes it's only a thin layer on top of the underlying configuration format for bind, which is very peculiar and have quite a bit of idiosyncrasies. So if you, for example, copy-paste something twice or copy-paste something without the trailing dot, then it interprets what you're doing differently than what you think you may be doing. And I'm afraid this is the case because that's how it seems to be resolving, and I had only a very small field there, so let me edit it again. Edit DNS for this domain. Yeah. The value is overflowing, so I kind of assumed it's correct, but if I go in deeper, yeah, it was adding dot .cz, so let me maybe just, if I go back on, there are some more secrets, unfortunately. So I'm deleting the trailing .dot.cz and checking again that I'm actually correctly CNAming to .herokudns.com, and it seems to be the case. So I have updated the DNS records. So now it should be redirecting correctly, but it will take a while for it to propagate. Now, meanwhile, we can fix what we did wrong there, which is forgot that run server command. And what was the ticket du jour? 63. This is what we're going to run now. So let's push and see and have a deal with it. Kinda late for a tea, but given this is taking longer than expected, the rest of the day it will as well. Alright, now I can see that, you know, this is cached, but what not everyone knows is that you can also ask a specific name server. So here I would ask the Google DNS, which of course still contains the old cache, but I can also explicitly ask my provider's name server, where we should have the current version. And you see that suddenly, no, that still resolves badly, although it correctly added additional resolution for the name servers, but now it resolves correctly. So see that the CNAME is for Heroku DNS, so delegation is set up correctly, we just now have to wait for it to propagate. I am not sure how it propagates into the local browsers. So that may be source of a problem. Plus, as I said, we probably don't have HTTPS. Yeah, this is still the old version. Never mind, let's wake. Wait, can take until an hour. Let's also configure add-ons. We can get rid of that Postgres. If it's possible to remove. Yeah. Yes, please remove the add-on. So, how's pipelines? Picking up the build time. 2 minutes, 2.5 minutes. Okay. Random roll dice. Success. Oh, status is partial outage. Of course. Whenever you try to demonstrate someone something. QAIO, whatever it is, that's a lot of subsystems, but that shouldn't affect us. What is it actually? It doesn't have a registry. Well, fair. Looking up upstream during outage, maybe not the best idea. So just now we have a deployment. So if this would go into the cache, then let's see what our curl does. And it serves the old version, the old resolution. I'm not sure there is a reasonable way to taint that cache. So maybe we just need to wait. I mean, unless and that I guess we can do is to temporarily resolve this guy, randomly pick one of those and overwrite our hosts. We just have not to forget to delete it after this session. This guy. Also, do you know why the cache is not working? Because I'm on a different computer. So, actually, maybe just running this on a computer I'm at instead of being SSH'd somewhere else is something that may help our problem without having to hard code stuff. This looks correct. This doesn't look correct. Never mind. But at least let's correct the, like, I mean, hard code on correct on correct computer. So this is the line we want. We totally don't need it here for the time being. And let's see what happens if we actually pull it out. So correctly, there is no HTTPS. But HTTP still serves the old version. So, and if we enforce the reloads, then we're good. This is the new version, which is down correctly. So, let's go for logs. From crash to starting. Web process failed to bind to port. Huh. Without saying anything to the console. Let's see. First starting performing system checks. 60 seconds, so let's see. Now, we definitely are port is propagating. I just do wonder whether the output logs are actually correctly propagated. I mean, so if we do what we're doing there, so, which I mean, we can connect to random port locally. So this works. If we say we're on production, then we require all those dummy keys. Fair. But one thing that ran through my mind is that what we may have actually done is trying to run a WASGI process, because that's how we've been running the production before. But that may not be how we're running on Heroku since you're running the run server explicitly. So let's just take a look. Oh, so they're recommending Gunicorn. And Django Heroku. Huh. And configure Celix files. We may give it a try. I mean, as a start. So that ask for requirements Django Heroku, which I don't like that this is going to go for non-production as well, but presumably shouldn't break anything, right? TM. So let's import it. Oh, adding locals. In which case, I mean, if you want to run your own version of this, that will require some alterations, but I would like to know what is happening there. I'm afraid it will also probably overwrite our database settings. Overrides login configuration, which we actually probably want. So databases we have set up. So settings. Accept keyword arguments. So let's say that databases shouldn't be configured. Okay, let's give it a try. I mean, before, let's verify that we haven't broken anything for the local environments. Why someone trying to build PsychoVG? My assumption would be that that's a sentry. Okay, does this still work? Looks like working. So, at Heroku integration, and actually before we push it, let's go with the G-Unicorn as well. And I do wonder whether that sets the port correctly. So G-Unicorn and the WASG we've been using was graveyard.wasg.application. So let's reuse that. Including Django settings. So the only thing that worries me is that port, but let's give it a try. Maybe it's reading the environment variables correctly. At least I would assume. No, and also what I wanted to double check is that we have Gunicorn in requirements. Yes, okay. So, let's deploy that guy. And flush the team. So we do have Gunicorn. Also of notes, this has been archived. I have missed it. 2 years ago and already deprecated. Wow. So why and what is replacement? Also, why don't you mark it there? This is only slightly annoying. Why don't you say what is a replacement? Oh, Authors was Kenneth Rice. So I think that the reason is that he left Heroku, if I remember correctly, but like, it wouldn't hurt if it would be set at the rep level that this is unsupported. Yeah. Anyhow, in which case it shouldn't be that hard to dissect what is actually happening there. We're not interested in databases. White noise middleware and astronomer for that matter. White noise middleware shouldn't be hard. Oh, allow the hot star. I'm not sure we actually want that. So this is why I want to know what the application is doing. The libraries that you use are doing. Logging stream handle may be a good idea. So I think that this actually asks for copy pasting instead of, you know, relying on a library that's deprecated. Also of note, I actually completely forgot how our logging looks like, but first let's make sure that we will do this going forward. So so merge Django Heroku into settings for future compatibility. Build failed. Well, maybe we will have to do that sooner rather than later. What's up? Django Heroku relies on base there. Okay, so back to what was our problem. It was porn binding. So we can migrate away from this later on because it sets locks, which is helpful. But meanwhile, let's connect the unicorn, because that's the one that should help with the problem we're having. And while it will be building, let's figure out this the logging. So, deleting Django integration, altering that in settings, which was that import on that last line. That's all we should need for time being. See, I thought that, you know, this episode is just going to be an on-git push Heroku and done. Always trickier. So let's push this guy. And meanwhile, logging. How do we have logging configured? We don't. That's always an option. Cute. I think that we can actually state a reasonable default here. Because what I think that the Django header was actually not bad. Based on, you know, quick skimming. Have I pushed? All right, I did, but it's waiting for CI. So what was in that integration map? Many tabs open. Was it on? Yeah. Shouldn't have more windows. So white noise were sorted afterwards. Logging is what we wanted to steal, at least as a skeleton, and just to make sure we are configuring the latest formats, because stuff is developing. Now, if this seems complicated, I think that you're correct, because this is how the underlying Python lock library is set up. Maybe let's actually just start with this manila one. Also, it would be good for them to clarify why do you need to import OS. Anyhow, well, graveyard was given on package. We are getting somewhere. So the way it is importing may not be expecting that application. Okay, well, let's do the base logging. Also, I mean, the reason why this is so convoluted in my opinion, is that it's clearly modeled after like how Java does logging. And the basic architecture actually makes sense in a way, but yeah, it is very fractal, let's call it. So we do have a logger and a stream handle. Let's just make sure we can still locally boot, I mean startup. Yep. I mean, sure, the unicorn is not a package, but I mean, the WSG application is not a package. But I thought that the ports file also asks for the object. But let's try without, okay. Okay, and let's commit only that for time being. So git commit. So, let's push those separately, so we know how we broke stuff. So this is the prots file, and then for the logging, what this will allow us would be to set more verbose logging just to environment variable, which we should see in the Heroku stream. So this is not a bad start. So let's just review what was in the integration, whether there was more. So it added the more of an Apache format for the formatter. What do we have in format? Nothing, we're using the default. We may want to do that. Having timestamps is useful. Yeah, I vote for using this. It is more practical. Now, also of notes, so let's see whether we have correctly corrected all the parentheses. So for martyrs, verbose and simpler, handlers, loggers. Okay, we should be good. But unlike the previous version, we can't set the level, and it also gives us test just the test logger, which we don't really want. Is this how it redirected? All loggers? That's weird. Let's let's take a look again on the original templates. So yeah, let's call this Django. There is no reference to that logger, right? No, there isn't. Handler is console that is the verbose formatter. That's correct. Root handler should also be console at the warning level that we should set up. I think it's good to overwrite. And wait, no. The warning level and for Django level, let's get that configuration. I'm thinking about why it shouldn't propagate, but I will go with the recommendation for the time being. Can we still load locally? Yep. So let's send it to production. So we see whether we do have a better results. Now let's see what happened to our previous deployment. Build succeeded, project listening can up. So let's see what we see. So this is the cache again. So let's enforce HTTP. And we are redirecting, and I think that's a configuration that we put in because we've been HTTPS only. Now, let me double check on Heroku whether you can have SSL for free. In settings, if not, I would do HTTP for time being. So upgrade to pay dynos. Hobby tier or above required for ACM. Okay, so for a moment, and for the purpose of getting this up, let's remove that redirects. And I think it was part of the production configuration here. So now I do understand why they do it, because although what is happening with ACM and with Let's Encrypt is that yes, you have a certificate for free, but you still have to do the key management and rotation. And Heroku is still just a layer on top of AWS. And on AWS, in case you want to manage certificates, you have to have the SSL termination point. And SSL termination point in there is the SSL termination point there is load balancer. And load balancer is not for free. I think it's like, I actually may have it here. Yeah. The application load balancer, I think you start at $20 a month per endpoint. So giving it away for free is probably not a very sustainable business model. So although I don't, I would prefer it otherwise, I do understand where this is coming from. So let's wait for those builds in this case. So 1 more minute. Better logging succeeded and deployed. There was one of our request IDs going through. Actually, speaking of have the cache soon through. So HTTP. So redirect the error log. So we see headers and not just data. And you see that on this computer this is still not there, but never mind. We don't really need it. Let's wait for the builds to kick in. And with that we should be almost done, except for that statics part that you'll need to configure. So let's meanwhile take a look how this is actually done. So we add white noise to middlewares. With storage. And potentially Broadly. Okay, which will have us to put in the front. URL. But what I don't see is where the CloudFront should be configured to get the data from. Your application's domain in the origin domain name. Okay, so what this is doing is that you don't upload the files anywhere. You just let CloudFront proxy it back to you. Fair. That is the default. Simple behavior I've been asking about. I'm just wondering, like, my preferred architecture is that as part of the build, you copy the static file somewhere like S3, preferably because it's super cheap. You know that it's definitely available when you start the app, you can prepackage it. It's Yeah, exactly. You can do hashes on fly. You can pre-compute hashes. You know, you have a consistent set of static files uploaded. Whitenance will only, it will not work with backends that solve files remotely. Wow. I mean, okay. That we can probably do as a start, but I don't like it, to be honest. This is a weird middle ground where you have to spend the time with the configuration, yet you don't really reap the benefits. So let's see. Okay, and is this because it's cached, or is this because there is still the redirect? So let's see on the local computer. The HTTP version. That seems to be still sending 301. Wait, but 301 not to HTTPS. 301 to actuality, which is actually correct, since that is the default page. Well, my guess would be that the app can't connect to the database. But let's wait for it to time out or to for it to show up somewhere. Request timeout, the best kind of message. Critical worker timeout. Now that I look at it, we don't have an application logs showing up actually. Sentry is sending zero pending error messages, so nothing for Sentry to collect. Although I have been setting it so that it should be configured correctly. God damn it. So Sentry was actually able to send something, it seems. It's just probably not relevant. So, no module app that we resolved. System exit. Fair. That's very hard to board. And it was an ensure connection. So sounds fair. Now my guess would be that my setup for RDS is not as open as it should be. And this we can actually verify. Sorry, someone's knocking on the window, but it's probably a bird. So you know how I've been saying that I wrote Terraform for that? So this is actually what we can now take a look at. This file is publicly available. It setups the RDS. As you can see, we do have it. We do have a security group and a subnet group attached, and the VPC security group should have. AWS security, oh god, this is always tricky. So the security group, that should be somewhere here. Yep. Should have RDS from the world. So that is from ingress from internet seer is what we wanted. So the second thing where this could be blocked is the network ACL, and here we are allowing everything on all ports, so that should work. And since you're doing this from the world, we should be able to verify that by connecting from local computer. So if I have there the MySQL client, which I do, then let me for time being go off screen, and let me just show you what I'm trying to do. So what I will do, so it's MySQL host will be the RDS host. On port that you saw, with a username against a database. This I will just fill in with the production data I'm testing, which of course means that I will have to again clear my caches. And this should give me the access, and if it doesn't, then something is wrong with the database access configuration. So let me just have it on the screen, just to be sure. Switch it to that console. Right, of course, I don't have the RDS host name there because I can find it in AWS RDS. If it hasn't signed me off, we'll see. No, for once. So let me copy paste that because I still kinda. It's secured by obscurity, but you know, given it's open to the world, I would rather not share it. So let's copy the password. Although maybe not needed, because it will not prompt me if the ACLs are wrong. And yeah. The connection is not going through indeed. So let me check the VPC security group. Right, so one more thing where this can go wrong. the way the networks are connected to internet are gateways. And the gateways may be set up for, let me check. No, we don't have a gateway. We don't have a security group. We do have inbound rules. Let me check them. We are consuming HTTP, SSH, and RDS. Oh, we are not notably not consuming HTTPS. I should fix that, although that is worth fixing. But we are connecting. We are connecting Aurora. Let's go back. One additional way to check would be routing, like routing table. So whether the inbound network is correctly routing correct traffic to the correct subnets. This is one of the trickier parts. So we have two internet gateways attached. Why? For fuck's sake. But I think that is because I have the implicit gateway, and then the one I have specifically created for this. But if I take a look at the route table that's connected to my subnet, yeah, whatever is routed outside of local network is routed to the gateway, which is correct. For some reason, someone somewhere is routing 172.31. Which I'm not sure what it is, but it sounds like another localhost designation that I don't remember. Yes, 172 is also private use, okay. We do have two ciders associated with that subnet. That has a correct VPC. That has correct ACL. Let me check inbound rules. Yeah, all traffic allow outbound rules. All traffic allow. So the only thing that I may want to check is that RDS is correctly available in those regions, which it should. Man. So DB instances. Wait, subnet group. Yep. The subnet group is correctly connected to do subnet to two subnets on two seeders. Yeah, everything's fine. Subnet OE, and this is the one B. That everyone is presumably on. Let me double check that. So I have one running instance of nano size. That is cool on the old projects. You can actually run production on nano. Subnet OEB. Yes, so 1.x, that's the availability zone 1B. Where we should have the gateway, let's just check it. Whether I'm not accidentally in the other subnet. Although RDS should be connected to both, but yes, no, I'm on the correct subnet. Right, let's just man. Right, one thing to check. Connect to MySQL server. One thing for me to check is whether that hostname actually resolved to something sensible. And here's my answer. This resolves to a localhost address, which makes sense. Because you only connect to you're only supposed to connect to it from internal network. So what we need is to set up an external connection point, so we can do like we connect to a hostname that resolves to a gateway that we have set up, and that correctly translates and routes to RDS. So let's see whether Amazon doesn't have something. Built in for that, but I can adapt so. Oh, new Amazon instances now have public accessible option for new instances during RDS creation process. Well, if only I would have done that. Because I'm afraid that that's going to be the... an attribute in Terraform. And I do wonder whether that's something that I'm able to change afterwards. Let me try. Yeah, public accessibility, no. I sense problems. So let's see whether modify allows me to do that. Or whether this will resolve. Yeah, public accessibility easy to instances and devices will come. Must. So I can change it actually. So my guess is that that can be changed to Terraform as well. So let me do that. My main beef with that is that it's potentially potentially dropping the database. This is a fun thing to do. So let's take a look. I have committed this, right or not? Yes. It's just my course of code catching up. So. Let's open the Terraform. This is where you trust your backups. Although I have to say that one slight problem with this. I've been actually running Terraform locally, I think. One slight problem with this is that I don't have proper snapshots or backups there. The reason being that I have we're running on MyZM as we showed not. Not InnoDB, and that doesn't support snapshots on Amazon. So we are kind of running low. So. This is where I have my Terraforms. Let me kill this for time being. is something. I do have something changed since the last time. That's not good. Since this should be all done and verified. So let me log in to my AWS console here. This is putting my AWS credentials into environment variables if it works. Unless there is a handshake timeout, whatever it is. Okay. So one of the disadvantages of having password manager in the cloud. So let me do that off for you, just in case of data leak. Okay, now it worked. So let me see what's the plan. Like whether this is a change I hadn't applied or I had. Right, and also for the purpose of being lazy, I do have RDS passwords done as an environment variable. And I don't have it tucked in my own password, of course. Well, let's hope it's this one. And let me make a better tag for this. So Terraform is refreshing state. And there is one to change, and the one to change is just disable API termination, which seems to be unrelated to my changes, so that's kind of weird. Let me commit those then. This is for picking up the user data. Let me just check what was that, because it felt like disable API termination. I would actually like to keep that. So for all my development comments, let me refresh the state again. And meanwhile, let's take a look. So that's Terraform's business. What can you set on RDS? And there should be an attribute. I would assume under P, publicly accessible. Let's try to set it to true and see what happens. So it was not as public as I thought. Terraform refreshed and said no changes. So let's do publicly. Publicly accessible true and do the Terraform plan again. And enter a password. I'm wondering whether to do that now because this asks for a production to go down. I'm thinking about when I'm running backups. let me just go to my account and make sure. That the backups I'm putting in are actually there, because I haven't been checking it since I set it up. And of course not. There is a hole because reasons. Fair. So in that case, let me stop it here and verify the proper backup before we're going to go this. So theoretically, as you can see, the Terraform plan is to just change this one attribute. Nothing should happen. TM. Let's start next time with that. And this should also bring us towards having this running on Heroku, so we can actually work on some features. So let me do a preparation on a proper backup lifecycle that I will verify. And actually have the CDN ready, so we can then just set it up and move on. So thanks to everyone who stopped by. Thanks for all the people, watching the snippets afterwards. And it's pretty rainy, so maybe see you earlier than next week. But I plan to go back and have this as a regular session. So thank you and have a nice day wherever you are.